Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Sabi Sands here in South Africa. We are on Juma Private Game Reserve, and we are just moments away from arriving at a hyena den site. Now, we did try and come to this den site this morning, but the adults had already left. They were here, and when the adults move off, the cubs go into their burrows within an old termite mound, and that's the end of the show. It could well have changed by now. That was quite a few hours ago. It was probably about 7 hours ago that we were last here. And the adults normally do leave in order to get a bit of peace and quiet and get away from the youngsters, which can pester them throughout the day if they were to hang around here. So they typically just come in, nurse the cubs, and then move off to relax. Adults may well have come back though to continue nursing before heading out this evening. And there's only one way to find out, and that's to come here and have a look. To any of you who may be joining for the first time, welcome. And to all the regulars. And it's important to know that it is a live safari, so it's actually happening as we speak this very moment. And it is also interactive, so you can ask questions at any given stage. And to do that, you would hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or send an email through to questions@wildearth.tv. The den site is still inactive, and within one of those two holes that Andrew is busy zooming into, you will notice that there's nobody lying up outside, and that's usually where the adults will lie while they nurse the cubs. You can even see some relatively fresh sign of animals walking around there. So the cubs will be in those two holes, and there's three cubs that we know of, one slightly older and two slightly smaller, but hopefully they will become active this afternoon, and I'm sure one or two of the other game drive vehicles will pop in here. If not them, we'll come back a bit later to see if anything's changed. But for now, we shall continue and look for something else interesting. Now, sadly, the mechanic working on our other vehicle has been having a hard time, and what we thought was the problem was certainly part of it, but not the problem as an entirety. And there's something else that's popped up now, so he's busy trying to tinker with that and hoping that he will have the vehicle up and running in time for tomorrow morning's drive. So apologies for that. We also just as frustrated as you are and would love to have two vehicles out on the ground.
There are a lot of flies around,
but it varies from area to area and day to day.
It's not related to the hyenas being here.
No. Okay. You'll find the worst place for flies at the moment are water holes, Andrew.
The bus.
So Andrew's been on leave for a couple of weeks and come back and realized that the flies have become a bit of a problem, and they really have over the last few weeks. So they're keeping us guessing. Nikki's in final control this afternoon, and just to let you know, she really enjoys all of you that before the drives are sending tweets from all around the world, various cities, saying hello and what the weather's like. And it is just great to know where all of our viewers are spread across the globe, so thanks for that. And it's also nice for us, Nikki does relay to us and tells us that there's people watching from all these different cities. Left or right? We shall go right. Actually, we'll go left. So, you would have noticed I was quite indecisive there as to where to go, and that's probably because there weren't too many sightings this morning, and usually you kind of build off what you know happened in the morning as a base for your afternoon drive, but not much has happened, so it's always a lottery out here, but this afternoon's especially so because we don't really know too much of what went on last night, and we don't know where all the animals have gone. But that makes it exciting, and now we can try and track them down and the surprise of finding new animals, not knowing that you will, we're not expecting to see them, is a rush that is actually often better than going to a confirmed sighting of an animal that has been found by somebody else. So we have that to look forward to. Go ahead. Kathleen in New York, good afternoon and welcome. I presume you weren't on the morning drive, and I should have mentioned that and recapped that the hyena have moved from their original den site where they've basically spent the months of February, March up till now, and it was just probably in the last few days that they've moved across to this current den site, which is one that they did actually use in November and December when we were initially filming them. So they do chop and change between their den sites, and at the moment they've just moved back to the one we poked our nose into now. Now, you would have noticed that it was mainly females of very young males in the majority of that herd, but now Andrew is panning across to a large male who's trailing behind this herd, and he's a bit too early, so this is for ego more than anything else, because the rutting season hasn't actually kicked in, so female impala will not be mating yet, and therefore him following them around at the moment, like I say, may purely be to boost his ego. He's not actually got a role to play here. But on the next full moon, we could expect, or there and thereabout, we could expect the male impala to start fighting very aggressively with one another, competing for territories. And within good territories, naturally, females will gravitate towards those areas, and then males who own these territories will have rights to mating. So these ladies are going to have a lot of attention from... Oh! He's just started. This is the first time we might be able to show you him rutting. And he is going to come back out. Listen. This is awesome. I hope he comes back. I'm sure he will. And here's another male on the right. Let's try and get on him. So there's a few males lurking around. Sadly, the one male that ran off was obviously doing it in thick vegetation. And he was also a little bit far away, so I don't think you would have been able to hear their funny gurgling, burping roar that they let off when they are competing with one another. But again, he wasn't doing it to the degree that they will be doing it when they are in full rut. So they're kind of warming up to it. Nikki says she could hear it faintly in the final control, so you may have heard some strange noises. That was from the impala. And I'm just going to wait here a moment or two. They may come back and chase one another through the small open clearing in front of us. So it's worth hanging around for, because it's entertaining watching them. I can still hear the remnants of them chasing one another around. So, and now that this other male has moved into the block where there were another two, that may add a little bit of heat to the equation and cause things to pick up again. A dangerous time for male impala, because running through thick vegetation, like you can see, leopards can creep up to them very easily, and while they're so concentrated on what they are doing, and that's competing with one another, they forget of the potential risks that are around them, and you often find lion and leopard getting easy meals. Just going to creep forward ever so slightly, and then we will continue to wait. So I'm fairly certain these males will come back, and hopefully in the small open clearing Andrew will be able to get some footage of them chasing one another. Okay, I'll stop here. So Andrew can see one coming back. Go ahead, Mickey. Got a question through from Tula in Finland. Good afternoon, Tula, and welcome on board with us. Tula would like to know what season it is here, because it's spring over there, but it looks awfully dry here. And you're right, it is awfully dry, but it is our autumn, you could say. We are heading into winter, but we don't have clearly defined seasons. The kind of summers just roll into the winters, so our autumn and spring is usually not very noticeable. But it is dry now, and it's abnormally dry because we didn't get as much rain as we would have hoped to get this summer. So it's a little bit drier than it should be at this time of the year, and this may mean some tough times for animals like the impala and the other herbivores. So, this male's now returned to the herd, but like I say, I very much doubt that he will be getting any opportunities to mate. The female impala will all mate in a very short window. And what this does is it means that they basically flood the market with youngsters when they give birth. And by flooding the market, it ensures that predators can only feed on so many of them when they are very small and vulnerable. And therefore it lessens the impact of predators on small impala. If they were to give birth over a staggered period, it would allow the predators to target the newborns as they are born each day over that 3-month period, for example, and that way it would create a much bigger dent in the young impala's populations. Afternoon, Aubrey. I've checked the Mnisikaya. It's not active. And no other updates that I've copied. Okay, well, we're going to leave these impala to it, because like I say, in the coming weeks we can expect a lot of good action from them. Go ahead, Nix. Just got a question through from Geza. Good afternoon, Geza. And Geza would like to know if there's any chance that the hyena have moved back to their original den. There is, of course, a chance, because anything is possible out here. But I find it highly unlikely that they would have already moved back. after only having been here a few days. So this male here, you can see, is also showing signs that we are coming into the rutting season. And he's rubbing his orbital glands, the small scent glands around the eye. Now, what is this impala alarm calling it? Has it seen a leopard? What has it seen? If it has seen a leopard, that would be great. Now, we're just trying to keep an eye on the direction they're looking in. But it could just be that it's windy and that their testosterone is beginning to increase as they do get closer to the rats. And in the wind, they will be very nervous because the approach of predators is muffled by the noise of leaves rustling and even the movement. Of the leaves can scare them. Just seeing the, well, what is it? Surely there might be something here. But I think they just saw a small bush that even actually looks a little bit like a leopard. It's a dead bush that I even double checked. Who knows? We will still keep our eyes peeled, and I'm actually going to stay with them for a few more moments. But I think it was just, I can actually show you the bush that I think it was that they were looking at. You see down through there, Andrew, there's that like kind of, yeah. It's down there, but it's a little bit high for it there. If you just zoom in now and down to the left a little bit, keep zooming in. Beyond that there, there's a kind of bush that looked kind of leopardy, but difficult to see. There you can see as we go past. But the wind makes the prey animals nervous. So these males, even though in a few weeks they're going to be competing fiercely with one another, they still realize the benefits of safety in numbers, and it certainly increases their likelihood of not being caught by being in these groups with extra eyes and ears. Go ahead. We've just got a question through from Toby in Wisconsin. Oh, look at that male at the back there. He's really giving his orbital glands a serious rub on that little cluster leaf. And their eyes will continue to blacken with the liquid that comes out as they scent mark on bushes. Now this other male is going to also mark his territory. Let's see if they're not going to get a little bit excited and chase one another. Come on. Now a third on the same bush. I think it's a combination here of a display of strength as they hit the bushes from side to side, but they will also be rubbing their orbital glands as they go. No, you don't want to mess with one of these boys. An impala in the rutting season. Yeah, you look mean. He's like, okay, enough now. great, well, it's wonderful that we're seeing all these signs of them coming into the rutting season rather than just one day showing you them chasing one another around at full steam. So these are just the initial stages, and you can look forward to some serious action as the weeks unfold. But for now, they're just building up momentum. So back to Toby's question. Toby has noticed that it is very dry, and would it be likely to get bushfires here from lightning strikes or just simply people being careless with fires or runaway fires? And yes, there certainly are fires in the Sabi Sands, and they can be caused by lightning strikes, which they often will be, but that's typically towards the end of winter when our first summer rains come through, and with those electrical thunderstorms that bring in the first rains, lightning strikes. Ooh, there's a beautiful bird here. Please, can it stay? No, it won't. It's not one that usually does hang around, but we're going to hunt it down. No, it's teasing us. So yes, indeed, we do have fires, and in my 3.5 years in the Sabi Sands before starting again with WildEarth here, we had many fires, some caused by lightning and others caused by runaway fires that were supposed to be controlled, or lodges burning down and then setting the reserve alight. There's obviously different ways that a fire can start, but yeah, fires are a reality, and it is scary fighting fires out in the wilderness, because especially if they happen at night, you can really get into some hairy situations, as when you're fighting the fires, you're in an area with so many dangerous animals. I remember one night fighting a fire. Actually, it was in the Kruger Park, not in the Sabi Sands. But we had parked the vehicle and we were jumping off with fire beaters. So it's essentially a really strong broomstick or pole with a big rubber mat on the end of it. And you'll go up to the fire and beat it at the base with this big mat, and that suffocates the fire and can be very effective at putting out fires. So there was a team of us with these beaters that were heading towards some flames, and we didn't want to park the vehicle too close to the flames in case that fire picked up and burnt the vehicle. So we probably had 100 meters to walk. It was fairly open, but it was dark. And I just heard these pounding footsteps coming towards me, and I stopped and just kept still because that was all I could really do. And then I saw a huge rhino come running past me. And thankfully it was just running away from the fire, and it was on a slightly different course to me. But those are the kind of things that happen when fighting fires out here. I'm hoping we won't have any until, in all likelihood, late winter going into summer, when it is mainly lightning strikes that will cause the fires to start. But it is natural, and it's one thing that is difficult to manage. Even though we are part of a massive ecosystem, it can be very difficult to manage fire, which used to occur naturally on natural cycles and is necessary to burn out old dead plant life and create space for new life to come through. So depending on the vegetation and the biome that you're in, fire may be necessary once a year. In other areas it may be necessary once every 5 years. Either way, it can be difficult, because now we as humans have to try and get involved and burn certain patches at certain times, and those fires that are started either as controlled burns or burning fire breaks sometimes get out of control. And that I guess it's probably 50-50 lightning to man-made fires that contribute. Go ahead. Just got a question through from Charlie. Afternoon, Charlie, and welcome. Charlie would like to know whether the horns of impala can be used in their defense against predators. And they certainly could be used, but sadly, the impala don't know their own strength and actually don't use their... I'm not sure what I can see there, and I'm just gonna double check with my binos. They don't realize that their horns could provide defense to themselves against predators, and therefore only ever run away from them. I've never seen an impala attack any animal. So it's just, as you say, Charlie, for intra-species competition. It was just a termite mound, a very small one, out to the left there that I thought may have been something interesting like a leopard. So here we are at Treehouse Dam. And it's a place where we have found numerous leopards, but it doesn't look like that is the case necessarily this afternoon. Not right now though, that could change in half an hour and a leopard could pop up here. Or there could simply be one here that we have just yet to see. One thing I can assure you is that as the vegetation does dry up, it is becoming easier to spot leopards. However, there is one kind of twist to that tail. Even though it's becoming clearer and we can see further into the bush, the coloration is more suited for leopards' camouflage now. As in summer, when everything's bright green, their gold coat can stand out, whereas now there's a lot of golds and oranges that help them to blend in. Nice. Well spotted, Andrew. Now, these are such awesome animals to watch, and we sadly don't often have them hanging around like this, and it's great when they do. Now, has this one gone into a small cavity in the tree? I think it may have, or has it simply just gone around onto the other side? Either way, you'll notice that part of the tree that Andrew zoomed in on contains a lot of mud. What I'm going to do is, I'm just going to jump out and give you an idea of how high that mud is up the tree. And it goes much higher than me, so you can take a guess as to what animal you may think that is. It's an animal that's very tall and likes covering itself in mud. And I'm just under 6 feet tall, so that'll give you an idea of how tall the animals are that were rubbing themselves on that tree. And it would have been elephants that have come down to the dam on our right hand side. And it is here where they would have churned up the mud with their feet. There's currently just some buffaloes lying here at the dam. But the elephants would have churned up some mud with their feet and thrown it all over their body before coming and rubbing themselves up and down these marula trees. This one was perfectly bent for the job. Well, these buffalo bulls are the local characters at the waterholes at this time of the year and spend a lot of time here relaxing, just chewing the cud or ruminating. Go ahead, Nix. Susie in California, good afternoon, and I hope all is well in California and that you're having a great day. Susie would like to know whether the snake populations of this area will slow down in their activity in the coming months as we do go into the winter, and they certainly will become less active, but certain species actually will mate in winter. The puff adder is one that comes to mind, and it is a snake that we saw just a few, probably a week ago, and had such a great sighting. Such a great sighting of this puff adder. And well done, Andrew. So there's this brown bird popping along the road here, and it's got a very distinctive orange eye and lets off a very loud call, and they're all coming down, which is great. They're usually quite secretive and we don't get to see them very often, or at least certainly not out in the open. That may be trying to feed on it, I guess. And we'll notice these changes in animals' behavior as we do get into the winter. Because food becomes more scarce, animals have to start changing their habits a little bit, and this is a great example. These birds are typically quite shy and seldom seen out in the open. Yet now, as food begins to already dwindle, they are mixing things up a little bit. Well done there, Andrew. And those were arrow-marked babblers. I was going to possibly quiz you on as to which bird it was, but I felt they didn't provide you with the best view to be able to identify them. I'll just stop and spend a few moments with this buffalo. We've got a few oxpeckers. On them, the closest one to us. Well, they all appear to have a few oxpeckers. Sorry, Andrew, I keep. Go ahead. Sorry, Nix, not copying you. So they're all busy doing exactly the same thing, and that is chewing the cud. So they've got a four-chambered stomach, and they will very efficiently process their food. And that's why when you do look at their dung, it's a very fine mush that you cannot tell exactly what it is they fed on, because they've broken it down so effectively. Elephants, on the other hand, are not ruminants and have a very poor digestive system, so you can almost see exactly what it is they've been feeding on. So just like cows, the buffaloes will chew the cud. And while doing so, the oxpeckers will also be looking for some food, and that's right on the buffalo that we can see. So these little birds are looking for parasites. It's very useful for the buffalo, as they are providing him free service. Oh, and here's another one that's come to join in the feeding frenzy. So just to let everybody know, two things actually. Firstly, Mark will be returning tomorrow afternoon to start work on Friday, so we're looking forward to having Mark back. And Brent will be leaving on Friday to just for a few days though to go to a wedding. So a few small changes in terms of the crew that you can expect over the next couple of days. And also, just a reminder to those of you who have yet to hear, we are changing our Safari Live schedule ever so slightly, and that is to coincide better with the changing season and go out at more optimum times than what we currently are doing, because we're kind of working off a summer schedule now in terms of the times we're heading out. So basically, as of tomorrow, we will be heading out at 6:30 a.m. Central African time, so half an hour later basically than what we currently are doing. And in the afternoons we'll be heading out at 3 p.m. Central African time, which basically means we'll be heading out an hour earlier than we are currently doing. So half an hour later in the morning we start, and we start 1 hour earlier in the afternoon, but it's still a 3 hour broadcast for both drives, unless of course we find something interesting. And then we, just like we always have, will extend. So, just to let you know that. And I'm looking forward to those changes and times, because it will, I think, get us out there at better stages of the afternoon to be exploring, and also the morning. Well, you'll notice the weather's still overcast, so nothing's changed today. And the only thing that we would have liked to have happened is for there to have been a little bit of rain, of which there has been none, sadly. But it's nice and cool for us. The wind's died down now, but it could simply be that we're in a bit of a valley here. But it is strange, when it's windy and overcast, everything seems to kind of hide away. I wonder where all of the animals go, but it does often tend to be quieter. I think it's the wind that's the main issue. Go ahead. Well, Nikki's just mentioned that there's quite a few people that are interested in what may happen to the crocodile that's at Buffleshook Dam. Well, some of you may already know this, but we feel that the crocodile has moved off from Buffleshook Dam. We haven't seen it for the last few times we were there, and there was also tracks of a crocodile seen fairly far from that dam, but he would have had to travel a long way to get to the dam in the first place, the crocodile that we have been viewing for the last few weeks. So I do intend on heading up there this afternoon and we can have a look for ourselves, but the last time I was there, there was no sign of the crocodile at the dam. And therefore, I guess that answers your question. Even though it hasn't dried up yet, for whatever reason it is, the crocodiles decided to move on. And they can cover large distances on land. So they will simply move when they need to. Another thing crocodiles could do in extremely dry areas is actually estivate, so basically go into a state of dormancy when it's very dry. And they can do that in caves or small banks in the waterhole or near the dams or riverbeds where they've been. And they can basically switch their body off for months on end without feeding, without doing anything. We are just so close to these go-away birds. I didn't see them until the very last minute. But the one, thankfully, has stayed for us. And isn't this a beautiful sight? You've got to wonder how they managed to keep that crest so perfectly intact out here with all of the dirt and little burrs that could get stuck on it. Beautiful. So this is the grey go-away bird, and they're called go-away birds because their sound rings out as if they're saying go away. It goes something a little bit like this. Quang!
Like how?
Like quang! And there's a few other go-away birds that you do get in further north, up into East Africa and other parts of Africa. But there's just the grey go-away bird that we get here in the Kruger National Park, and then a few of their cousins, which are called terakos. Now their cousins are often far prettier and far more brightly coloured than the go-away birds, but they are very similar and actually used to both be called lurries. So that used to be called the grey lurie, and now it has changed to a grey go-away bird. And what used to be called the purple crested lurie has now become a purple crested terako. So the birding world likes to keep changing names and mixing things up. So you very often may know the name of a bird, but it may not be the correct name for the current period, as the names do change. And it's not touching me clearly. Copy, we'll just stand by a moment then. How's it, Texan? Hello, everyone. Very good. Very, very good. Where are you headed? I'm going to follow you.
I'll come back inside in a little while.
Okay, cool.
I'll call you if I find something.
Thank you very much. Good luck. I'll slowly head up to Buffalzook Dam, I think, is my plan.
You're gonna go Nyala Dam?
Nyala Road, yeah.
I'll go. Maybe I'll see.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Cheers, everyone.
Cheers.
That was our friend Texan, who is one of the guides for Juma Maestro, so we often rely on him for finding us animals. And that's why I just made a joke with him that I'm going to follow him around this afternoon. Just driven down the very road that we are driving up, which I guess is not ideal because it's just been checked. But there's nothing to say that any animal parts at any given second from a thick wall. Question through from Karen in Texas. She's interested to know whether it's just a myth that rhino have been known to actively try and put out fires. And as far as I'm aware, that doesn't add up. It could well have happened on one rare occasion somewhere that was documented, but I find it highly unlikely. And the only time I've ever seen a rhino next to a fire, it was running away from it. So, it certainly wasn't aiding in the firefighting that evening. And, yeah, when you think about it, I mean, a rhino is not equipped to, in terms of its brain capacity or even the tools to try and put out a fire. That's not to say, though, that a rhino hasn't been confused before and caught in a fire and seen stomping all over. There was a tiny little bushbuck that ran across the road. I don't want to even move a muscle and see if Andrew can somehow get a view of it in there. Oof, well done, Andrew. So you can see it in there, and if it just takes a few steps forward, it is going to pop into a little clearing. So we're just going to wait. It's a really cute antelope, and we don't get to see many bushbuck.
He thinks we can't see him.
Exactly. But I wonder where your mother is. Where's your mother? Occasionally, the leopard and or lion will catch adults and their young will be stranded. Now, I'm certainly not saying this is the case, but it is why I am already thinking, is there not a bushbuck kill nearby and this youngster has therefore been orphaned? We saw something very similar with an impala in January last year. I'm fairly sure it was January. And Karula, a female leopard, had killed an adult female impala, and the young baby impala was hanging around very close to where its mother had been killed, hoping to find its mother again. And it was the next day that the leopard then heard this baby impala calling its mother, and it instead attracted the leopard, which came and killed it too, which I guess was good in a way that it put it out of its misery, because it would have starved anyway. Just going to roll forward ever so slightly. Oh, that's a bit better. But this bushbuck appears a bit too small to be all on its own. Well, I think this little bushbuck is terrified about having us own, and there it goes. We'll just keep a very close eye out for anything abnormal here, because unless it was behind its mother, which I find unlikely, because then it would have been more prone to follow down the river, and the mother has not followed the youngster from behind, it kind of is making me feel like something doesn't add up. Look, maybe its mother had been killed by a leopard but days ago, and it's managed to survive and move away from where it did lose its mother. Who knows? I'm certainly going to have a very close look around here. And the best place to look would be up in the trees. For the kills, which may be dangling there. I haven't explored this little section of riverbed for a while now, so we may as well just head down here and see if we don't find anything interesting. There's one more large jackalberry tree. That would be a perfect place for a leopard to hang out. We'll check there quickly, failing that, we'll turn around and continue up to Buffalo's Dam and see if there's any sign of the crocodile still there or anything else along the way. My favorite places to drive through these riverbeds. This little riverbed does turn into a dead end up ahead, so we won't go all the way because it gets a little bit tricky turning at the end of that riverbed. Did that? So it's not going to be easy, but a parrot has just landed up in this tree. And Andrew's just zooming in on it. Well done, Andrew. Great work. So like I said, not the best visual. It's a bit far away, but you can certainly tell that it is a parrot, judging from that short, curved beak. And even its posture and body shape, albeit fairly well obstructed by a branch in the foreground at the moment. This is a brown-headed parrot, the only parrot we get in this area. And we don't get to see them often, that's why I did stop in a hurry as I saw it land in this tree. The best sighting I remember was watching one drink at Twin Dams just a few weeks ago. And we actually saw 2 days in a row, maybe not the same one, but we saw one of these brown-headed parrots drinking in the afternoon as well as the morning. We'll leave this one to it though, because it's not very close by. Good work on camera there, Andrew. Just something for all of you to bear in mind, that probably the trickiest thing for the cameraman is every time we stop, the vehicle is probably is very often not flat. Or, you know, perfectly horizontal, and therefore the cameraman has to adjust the spirit level on the tripod, which takes a little bit of time. So it's not as easy as them just zooming in and pointing the camera at the animal. They have to level everything off and then start worrying about what to do next. Just beginning one of my favorite roads on the property, and that's more because of scenery than sightings that I've remembered seeing on this road. We haven't had too many sightings off this road. One of Kunyuma down on the riverbed up ahead, he had a bushbuck kill that Brent found. Other than that, there hasn't been a great amount of sightings here, but I just love the scenery and the way the road weaves from side to side. Go ahead. Just got a question through from Sandy in Palm City. Good afternoon, Sandy, and I hope all is well with you. Sandy is interested to know whether Kwatile, a female leopard that was on this property last night, has now moved off and back to her own territory, leaving Karula, the female who is dominant in this territory, leaving her territory essentially alone. And it's hard to tell. None of those leopards were located that I know of this morning. I did have tracks of one female leopard crossing out of our property, although I don't know whether that was Kwatile or Karula. So could have been either one, but I'm guessing that Kwatile would well have moved off. She didn't come here looking for a fight with Karula. She simply came here following Mvula, the large male that she was mating with. So I personally don't think there's anything to worry about then. I think Kwatile will be long gone for a while. We probably won't see her. Good question though. And sadly, we don't actually know where either of those two leopards ended up. How are the flies treating you?
I love it.
So good to hear that Andrew has already become great friends with the flies, so much so that he actually says he loves them. So clearly they're getting on very well, so great to have some of the local animals welcoming Andrew back here to work. And nothing like having a few flies buzzing around your face just to make you feel important. Okay, but seriously, back to business now. Let's find some animals. It is time to find something interesting. So that's from Nikki's request in the final control room, and I really would love to spend some time with some elephants too. Sadly, that seems they've all disappeared off of our property in the last few days, and we eagerly await their return, but there's been no fresh sign of them here on Juma. It's nothing to be concerned about. They do come and go, and they aren't territorial. They've got massive areas that they roam through, and they basically go wherever they're feeling lucky with food. So like I say, no concern to the elephants. It's merely that they've moved off our property for a few days, and I'm sure we'll be back at some stage. Who knows, maybe this afternoon. Maybe they were already back and we just don't know. But we haven't seen any fresh sign of them. So sadly, elephants are a tricky one to try and track. But we are heading towards a waterhole now called Buffalo's Hook Dam. And we've had some great elephant sightings there over the last few weeks. And maybe they'll surprise us there this afternoon. It's risky, but Andrew's going for it. There's a heron flying off, but it's dropping down quite rapidly below the horizon. But he's just got it in time, and you can see those very characteristic long legs and coiled up neck of a heron in flight. Well done, Andrew. And it's always great having a cameraman on the back of the vehicle that points at something that he knows is going to be difficult to film, and then nods with a big smile on his face as he motions that he's going to go for it. And he pulled it off. So, well done, Andrew. Oh, well, it looks like we might have quite a cute sighting here. Welcome back, and apologies, this road that we are on has some patchy signal depending on the day, and it appears like it's one of those days. Now, these two Cape turtle doves were sitting right next to one another, huddled up. It was a really cute scene, but they've now spread apart a little bit, and we're now facing, oh, here they go. Are they going to snuggle up again? Come on, snuggle up. They really were tucked up against one another, keeping warm. And just as we stopped, they decided to do some preening. As you can see, the one continues to do it. But they are quite cold, and they've ruffled their feathers up to create a thicker layer of insulation to keep them warm. I just want to give it another minute or two. I feel they might snuggle up with one another again. That was a loving little peck on the cheek there, it looked like. Wouldn't it be nice to know who's who? Who's the male, who's the female? Very difficult to tell. But the men are now coming up on the reason why we stopped to view them, and again, one's busy preening the other lovingly. It appears that the one that is being preened is not really appreciating it, rather. Well, maybe the one who's doing the preening's got some making up to do.
It looks like a bit of tough love to me. It always fascinates me, like, why would one bird preen it, the other bird? Like, what's going through their head?
Yeah, no, they care for one another. They do have some...
Shows something, right?
Yeah.
Almost like altruism.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, we'll leave them to it. It looks like the one's getting a little bit embarrassed now and is acting like nothing ever happened. So we'll leave the lovebirds. Good work there, Andrew. Now, like I said, the signal does get patchy through here, but it won't take us long to get through this area, so if the signal does cut out, don't go anywhere, it'll just be a few moments till we're on higher ground at Buffalzook Dam. Welcome back, and apologies for that short break. It really is interesting how, depending on the day, the signal varies, but cloud cover obviously has an impact on that, I'm guessing. Today we'll use it as the excuse. And it's perfect timing, we're just about to arrive at Buffalzook Dam, you didn't miss out on anything. Just a little bit of the scenery, I guess. Which is beautiful, it doesn't matter where we are on this property, there's... different scenery that caters to everyone's desire. No problem. Texan's also here, but he is making his way on, so we'll just stop behind where he's just checked. So it appears that Texan and I have got a similar idea of where we wanted to check this afternoon. Sorry, Andrew. We'll just stop here for a moment and see what we can see from this part of the dam. And it's just two buffalo bulls and a lone hippo that I can see at a first glance. There'll no doubt be some water birds along the fringe of the water. Now I'm guessing this is the same hippo that frequents this waterhole. There's just been one that we are noticing here at Buffalo's Hook Dam at the moment, but that does change with time, and it was just a few weeks ago, maybe a month now, that there was a considerable amount of hippo in this dam, maybe about 10 or 12. But they've moved off, and again, it's normal for animals to start moving and searching for food as it becomes less and less. The hippo will be looking for grass. That is what they feed on. And they're nocturnal feeders, so they spend the day in the water. And the afternoons and early mornings into the evenings out on land grazing. Well, there's another reason why I'd like to hang around in the northern section of our property, and that's because the Nkuhuma Pride of Lion have been seen heading towards our property, but still have a bit of distance to cover. But hopefully if they do continue towards us, they may well pop in this evening. And it really would be wonderful to see some lion. As you can see, no sign of the crocodile here, but that's not a problem because there's still one place to check, but I do fear that it may well have moved off, and that is sad because they're such wonderful animals to watch. And I was hoping it was going to provide us with some great viewing at this waterhole as it becomes more and more active. I've never personally seen a crocodile catching a large prey animal. I lie, I've seen crocodiles catching wildebeest in the Masai Mara as they cross those large rivers, but it's not difficult for the crocodile, and these massive crocodiles literally just swim up to the hundreds and thousands of wildebeest and zebra that are swimming across the rivers and grab onto them. But I've never actually seen one launching up and catching a prey item that is drinking, which is something that's always intrigued me. I've seen this very crocodile that was here catching something, but those were terrapins, so the freshwater turtles that we get in the river systems and dams in this area. And it ate about three within 15 minutes that we were sitting here. But was hoping to see it catch something a little bit more substantial. Now it's incredible how peaceful and quiet . So that was a very crocodile-like log that Andrew spotted, and definitely worth double-checking. But I fear the tracks of the crocodile that were seen about a mile south of this waterhole was probably the same tracks of the crocodile that used to be at this dam. Now, there's been a few requests for the sound that a hippo makes. And because this one's not performing for us, I'm going to have to act like a hippo. And I'm going to let off the noise that a hippo makes. It's a really interesting one. So, get ready. It goes something a little bit like this. So, I'm not sure if this hippo even twitched its ears in our direction. I was concentrating on the call. But that is the bizarre noise that you'll hear from hippo. And it is a wonderful call to hear. Very good questions come through, and I should have mentioned something. It appears like it's raining from all the little droplets you can see on the water, but they actually aren't droplets, they are bubbles that are surfacing from the activity going on underneath the water. So obviously there's a lot of life underneath this water hole that we cannot see, and for some reason it's causing all of these bubbles to rise up from below, which gives the impression that it's raining, but it's actually not. Andrew for Scott. Afternoon, Andrew. I'm just wondering how far north of the Buffalo Cutline are those in Gala? Okay, copy, thanks. I'll just hope and pray that they get active and come south. Thank you. Thanks very much. Well, seeing as though all is quiet at Buffalo's Hook Dam for now, we shall continue. And what I plan to do is do a loop around this general area, but I would like to stay up in the north, and the reason being is that the lion are close by. By close, I've been told they're just over half a mile away. One second, I've just heard quite an important update. Texan confirmed they're coming west from Chilakatlan pipeline. Ah. Okay, copy. Tex has found some female leopard tracks. But he's not sure whether they're from this afternoon or this morning. There was a whole family of hornbills here, but Murphy's Law, as soon as we try and zoom in on them, they decide to flutter off. There's still one or two floating around, and it's an adult with, well, two adults with their offspring from the air. And this is one of the offspring. We can tell because its beak is still about half the size that it will be when it grows up. So this would have been born just a few months ago, or hatched rather, just a few months ago, in November or December in all likelihood. Go ahead. Got a question through from Norm. Afternoon, Norm. I hope you're well. Norm is interested to know why we don't see more bushbuck, and it's a good question. There's a few different theories. There's a lot of Inyala in this area, and Inyala can compete directly with bushbuck and outcompete them because they're slightly taller than the bushbuck, so they can feed on everything that the bushbuck can feed on and more. And this allows them to do well, and because there's more Inyala, it's more intense competition for bushbuck, so there's not the hugest population of bushbuck here, which is one reason why we don't see them very often. But another reason is simply because they do live in thick vegetation a lot of the time and are quite shy and secretive. So a few contributing reasons to that. But that's normal. You can't expect animals of every species to do well in every single area. There's certain habitats that they do very well in, and others not so well, and that's for all species across the board. One problem I fear we face with regards to the lion coming into our property this evening is that we've been feeding on a giraffe for the last 3 or 4 days and are therefore now very lethargic and full-bellied. So hard to tell or predict when they're going to get up, but we can assume that it's going to be later rather than sooner. But there still is a chance that they'll pop in before the end of drive. But just filling you on the likelihood of that.
Did you say the Umas took down a giraffe?
Sorry?
The Umas took down a giraffe?
Yeah. And you'll notice Andrew is quite surprised that the Nkuhumas managed to catch a giraffe. And it is very impressive. Giraffe are huge animals and dangerous to hunt. If you get kicked by a giraffe, it hurts and it could even kill you. So, tricky business for lion. And also that coupled with the fact that we don't get many giraffe here means they don't get to practice very much. So they are certainly not seasoned giraffe hunters, and very interesting that they managed to catch one. see it running off, but we can try. Oh, might work. Well done. You would have got a glimpse of the common dyke or grey dyker that Andrew spotted there. As their name suggests, though, it means diver. And they do dive through the bush, as we just saw. And typically don't hang around to help us with sightings. Go ahead. Just got a question through from Kathy. Good afternoon, Kathy, and I hope you're enjoying this afternoon's drive. Kathy is interested to know why she doesn't see elephants around the marula trees anymore. And the reason why, Kathy, is that the marula fruits are only kind of ripe and in season for about a month of the year. So it's during that month period that you'll notice elephants rushing from marula tree to marula tree to gather up all the fruits that have fallen from the tree. And the elephants even sometimes aid in the fruits falling by shaking huge marula trees, and hundreds of the fruits fall down as these elephants use their immense size and strength to shift these monstrous trees. And we may as well stop and look at a marula tree while we continue to discuss them. So this is one here on our right. Now, interestingly, with the marula trees, Kathy, the fruits are seasonal, like most fruits, and like I say, will only really be ripe for roughly a one-month period that allows the elephants to cash in on this bounty of very nutritious and tasty morsels. The marula fruits are exceptionally high in vitamin C, and I guess that's what the elephants love. They're also sweet and will contain a lot of sugars, like most fruits. But it's mainly the month of January that you see them feeding on them, depending. But this year it was January that the fruits ripened. And they'll have to wait now until next January to feed on the fruits of this tree. Interestingly also, just so that you know, not all marula fruits will bear, marula trees will bear fruits. It's just the females. So you get males and females. And understandably, the males do not bear the fruits, and the females do. Also, Andrew, if you don't mind just zooming in on the bark quickly. Sorry, I'm just going to keep quiet. There's alarm calls. I could hear some kudu alarm calling. I think I know roughly where they are. So we will head in that direction, but there's no road that takes us directly here from there. There from here, rather. So back to the tree. The bark of the marula tree is very patched, and you can see the different patches and colors as Andrew zooms in and out, or up and down rather. So that's something very distinctive, and it's almost like puzzle pieces. It's not very deeply ridged. It's a very characteristic bark to look out for when identifying a marula tree. And then as he zooms up the tree, you'll notice that it has distinctly horizontal branches. And this is why leopards love these trees. It's because of the horizontal branches that create good platforms to lie on. This is not the most comfortable marula tree that I've seen, but it certainly is a marula tree, and it does have some horizontal branches. So that's something else to look for when identifying marula trees. Okay, we're going to continue. Even those alarm calls were not very intense and quite far from where we are, we've got nothing else to work on, so we'll take the next opportunity we can to head east and then back north in order to try and look around that area. Now heading east, and this is a small link road that will take us onto our eastern boundary, and we'll then continue north along our boundary cheetah cut line before finding, I'm hoping, a leopard or whatever it is that the kudu were shouting at. Question through from Nancy in Monopolis. I'm not entirely sure where Monopolis is. My geography teacher might be angry with me, but I don't know where that is. So please let us know, Nancy, where exactly Monopolis is. And good afternoon and welcome. Nancy is interested to know why we only see the big old buffalo bulls and very seldom, if not ever, the large herds with the females and the youngsters. And that's a good question, Nancy. It's simply because the large herds obviously feel that there's not the correct food and amount of food in this area, and therefore they don't come here to feed the many mouths that a large herd of buffalo does need to feed. The large older bulls that are kind of semi-retired don't have to worry about feeding hundreds of mouths and growing buffalo, and they can survive just eating the small bits and pieces that they find around Juma. But the large herds will typically need more open grassy areas than we do have on Juma. They have passed through in December a few times, and I'm guessing will come back at some stage as it continues to dry up in the winter, and they may exhaust food sources elsewhere. But sadly, there's just not the right food, and that's why they don't come here. It's certainly not because there's too many lion, because as you all know, we haven't seen a lion on Juma for quite some time now, and even when we do, it's generally pretty brief sightings. So it's not because there's too many predators, it's simply because there's not enough food. Where is this leopard? Well, the tricky thing is leopards can obviously, or any predator, can move either side of the roads, and they do. But this is kind of the general area that I thought I heard the kudu alarm calling. What's that up ahead there? Is it a log? Yep, this is what happens. You start going a little bit crazy and imagining things when you are desperate to find animals. So this I'm used to. Your brain can be extremely powerful and twist and contort random inanimate objects into whatever it is you want it to be. Okay, so Minneapolis is in Minnesota, for those of you who didn't know, like me. Go ahead, Lex. Thanks so much, Lex. I'm very interested. I'm just on Chilakatlan, opposite Katlan Junction now, so I'll head across there. Okay, well, some great news. There is an animal that I will not tell you exactly what it is, but it is heading towards our boundary from another adjacent property. So we are going to make our way there, and with a little bit of luck, we'll have something interesting to look at shortly. But before we do that, I've just spotted a bird in that tree there. I'm not sure what it is. I'm not entirely sure, but it looks like a warbird's eagle. It's not a great view. I was hoping it was an owl. So we shall continue. Buffalo dung that's been littering this road, and I'm guessing this would have been from a large herd of buffalo. Yeah, when you see this much buffalo dung together, it means there's a few of them. So there is a large herd of buffalo, meaning adults with their youngsters, that would have moved through this area but just snicked our property, which is to the left. Thank you. Okay, so I've just been thinking, listening to the radio now. Trying to work out what our best options are. We couldn't establish what caused that problem. We just had to turn the camera on and off to fix it. Okay. So folks, we're just having some trouble with the focus, so we're just going to have to turn off the camera and jiggle a few things around in order to get the focus corrected. So just give us a few moments and we will be back up and running. Welcome back, and we are getting close to an animal, I'm hoping. It's just a little bit of chaos because there's a bit too many vehicles there at the moment, so we're kind of going to have to hang back a little bit, which is fine, I'm in no rush. And there's no hurry here in Africa. If there is, you should try and avoid it, because things often take a little bit longer to get done out here. We're just going to slowly coast down into the general area of where we need to be. The lion have been looking to move south. They have got up, moved a little bit, gone back to sleep, moved a little bit, gone back to sleep. Excuse me. Which is typical behavior for lions. They don't just wake up and start marching, just like us in the morning. It takes a little bit of warming up. And especially when they are full of food, they can be even more inclined to move slowly. But good prospects, possibly not for this evening, maybe. If we're lucky, they'll cross on this evening. But I'm hoping tomorrow they'll be somewhere on our property performing for us. Hello everyone. Hey. How are you doing, Andrew? Doing, man? Very good, very good. Good. How are you guys?
Just up there, not far away.
I get to do it here.
I'm just waiting for Andrew to give us an update, folks. So just give us a moment or two here, please.
Yeah, I mean, Aubrey is going to hold the lock since I'm out, so just for you guys to get an idea if they're still up, where they're going to go.
Okay, cool.
But they're not far away from the digital there on the other side.
So okay, cool.
Okay. They've been a kilometer, so they're just long on
us. Okay.
But thanks. Like I said, the mobile stuff that you were able to see.
Thanks so much, Andrew. Have a good evening. Cheers, everyone. Have fun. Cheers. Andrew very kindly stopped there and he was just listening to an update on the Game Drive channel before he could give us an update as to what exactly was going on with the lion. He said they're not far at all from us, but sadly they're asleep now, so nice of him to take some time out of his afternoon to share some information with us. And he's a wonderful guy, Andrew, along with a lot of the guides out here. They're all so helpful and accommodating to us. Go ahead, Lex. Copy, no problem at all. Thank you very much for the updates. So, it seems like our luck is not ideal. Because, and now I've just heard another update on the radio. There was a young female leopard that we were hoping to go and have a look at. She was coming straight south towards this boundary road from right to left. But she's now changed direction and is heading east parallel to this road. So it doesn't look like she's going to pop out in an area where we can see her. And just after that message came through, Aubrey came through with another message saying that the lion are heading no longer in a southerly direction, but a westerly direction. Again, not bringing them any closer to where we need them to be. So we've just got some bad news with regards to two potential animals that we could have seen, or two different sightings rather. But that happens, Archer, and you can't let it bother you, because it is the way of the wild and the animals have got free rein to do exactly what they want. And I'd rather it be that way than us be able to determine exactly what they do. So all that means is we have to change our plans, but that is something you get very used to doing out here on safari. So we will just go and look around elsewhere for some action. Go ahead. Apologies, but not copying you well here. We can try again at the top of the next little hill here. Try again now, Nix. No, not copying you, and yeah, just do a short test before telling the whole story next time. It'll save you the efforts. Okay, well, darkness is setting in. I noticed Andrew's got the spotlights out behind me and is scanning for eyes of animals as we go. All good. Flying around, and sadly it would be close to impossible for us to try and show them to you, but they would have just woken up from their day of rest and are now hunting insects above us. And what wonderful animals to have around, the bats, to try and keep the insect populations in check. And they do a great job at it. They're a hugely important part of the ecosystem, bats. They consume huge amounts of insects. Much better. Go away. Lynn in Michigan would like to know why lions move such large distances through the different properties. Is it because there's a lack of prey, or is it just because they have large territories? And the two are basically hand in hand. They have large territories in order to, yes, acquire enough prey. And the bigger the pride of lion, the more mouths to feed, therefore the more prey required. But on the same token, the more lions in a pride, the more strength and ability to be able to dominate a larger area. But it certainly is food related. If there was enough food on any one property, they would probably stick it out. Yeah, there's just a dike sitting in the vegetation there, so good to double check. But we do not shine on any of the daytime animals at night. Yeah, a combination of factors, but lions, they do have big territories for various reasons, but mainly to be able to acquire enough food. In areas with high prey densities, lion will probably require smaller territories. And in reality, I think we are the ones that have got a small territory relative to the territories you do need to effectively be able to see everything out here. So we've got a much smaller traversing area than most of the game drive vehicles that traverse this area of the Sabi Sands. Well, there's a bush baby in this tree, but they're difficult to spot, but we're certainly going to try our best. Bush babies are really cute nocturnal primates, and we're gonna try and show you one, but I fear that this tree is too thick and that the bush babies are simply too fast when they jump around. No, I fear that this is a waste of our time, sadly. But it was worth a try. There was a little bush baby hopping around in here. Seems to be just one of those afternoons when the animals are about, but they're just not in the places where you want them to be. for those of you who are new to the Safari Live experience, it's important to know that at night, as I mentioned earlier, we do not shine on the daytime animals, so mainly the herbivores that we will not shine on. And that's to make sure that we don't leave them blinded and discombobulated, as we don't know if there are any predators around the next corner that may influence what they do. And I've just turned off my headlights now because there was a scrub hare close to the road, so that's why I dimmed the lights, so that we didn't blind the scrub hare. So we try as much as possible to not shine on those animals and only on the animals whose eyes are designed to see in the dark. And we're just looking for the reflection of animals' eyes as they glisten. And that is why we can shine the spotlights almost what appears to be haphazardly from side to side, as it's just the reflection we need to see before stopping to assess exactly what animal has caused that reflection of its eyes, from its eyes. Go ahead with update. Well, it's very interesting. There's message that's just come through saying there's noisy elephants just next to Juma, and there's some buffalo that you can hear in the bushes here. And I think it could have been that there's some buffaloes that are fighting. Well, sadly we can't shine the lights on them, but they are just off to our right. I'm just going to try and cast a very dim light over them. That's not working well, but I think it's... And thanks very much for that report to whoever did send it through. But I think it's two buffalo that are fighting and not in fact elephants. So we'll leave them to it. We don't want to get caught in the crossfire of some angry buffalo. Oh, there's one just ahead of us. So I'll leave the lights off for the time being as we coast past. But again, thank you very much for that update on the elephant noises coming from Juma Dam. And there's a live camera at this dam, for those of you who don't know, who gets controlled 24 hours a day from people all around the world who zoom in and out and around the dam looking for anything of interest. And it was an alert from this waterhole camera that they picked up some strange audio. I feel it's the buffalo that have made it. Try it. There's a bush baby jumping around again in this tree. There's actually, is it one or two? No, it's definitely one. Well done, Andrew. So that's who we were looking for earlier, a small nocturnal primate called a bush baby. And they really are such cute little creatures. They've got this incredible ability to spring from branch to branch, and that's why I've sadly left Andrew behind as this bush baby sprung from side to side. And We can creep forward a little bit and see if we can't get another closer view. But they can jump huge distances. I would even hazard 10, 12 feet as an easy length for them to jump in the dark from one little branch to another. Bush baby. Oh well, we did have a good glimpse of it, and sadly they do just move such great distances in such a short space of time. Makes following them easy. But I'm glad we got to share with you a glimpse of one of the smaller, less seen nocturnal characters we find here at Juma. Good. Just got a question through from Maria in North Dakota, and she's interested. Good evening, Maria. She is interested to know what bats we get in this area, and it's mainly insect-eating bats, not fruit-eating bats, but that's about all I can tell you. It's the insect-eaters we get, not the fruit-eaters. So sadly, that is all I know about the bats of this area. However, not far from here in other parts of Kruger, I have seen amounts of fruit bats, so they may trickle into this area, but I've yet to see any large epauletted fruit bats, which is a type of bat that we do get in the Kruger, not far from here. So maybe the large epauletted fruit bat does make its way into the Sabi Sands, but not that I've seen. Been quite a few requests for us to try our best to track down a pangolin or an aardvark or a porcupine. All nocturnal animals that we see very rarely in what would have been 4 years now spent in this area. I've seen one pangolin, and even though they are predominantly nocturnal, they do move during the day, and I saw my one during the day. And that was at the end of my 3.5 year stint at a camp here. I saw my first aardvark yesterday morning. There's another bush baby, but this one was too quick. There's still hope. We may be able to see it. Once I made that noise and bush babies came jumping out of the trees towards me, but it was just a once off. So I was just trying to see if that little squeaking noise would attract this one, but I obviously just got lucky once upon a time. And it's just sitting in amongst those. Oh, there, it's just jumped. But I don't think we're going to get a good view of it. It's just in the bush that's simply too thick. And it seems to be a little bit shy, so we'll leave it to its own devices. As I was saying, the first aardvark that I've seen in the Sabi Sands was yesterday morning. It was being fed on initially by a leopard, and then some hyena came in to finish it off. So that was the only aardvark I've seen, and it was dead. Porcupine I've seen very few times, but probably a handful in my time here. So all three of those animals, very difficult ones to see, but there certainly is a chance of seeing them because we're out here in amongst it. And that's the only way to increase your likelihood of seeing anything is to be here. Got another small interesting animal to look at. This one's not going anywhere though. Tricky business, fine-tuning the lights and the settings and everything at night. So Andrea appears to have got it beautiful, and you can probably notice that there's an animal sitting in there facing us. We have woken it up, but we're going to leave it and it will go straight back to bed. But this is a chameleon, and it was sleeping until we came along, so we won't hang around too long and disturb it. But it's certainly a lot easier to see these animals at night than during the day, because their body is often a slightly lighter shade than the bush that they are sitting in, and it's quite an easy obscurity to notice within a whole bush of a uniform colored leaf, that one appears to be slightly off, and the slightly off-colored leaf often turns out to be a chameleon. We'll leave it to it though, and hopefully it's going to have a peaceful night's sleep, as I'm sure it will. Good question, Andrew. Andrew's just asked if the chameleons prefer sitting in different trees, and I'm sure depending on which trees are flowering and fruiting, that may have an influence at that specific time of the year, because the more bugs being attracted to any given tree would obviously be a more likely place for a chameleon to base itself, where there are lots of kills that are available to be made. But I haven't noticed that these chameleons, which are the flap-necked chameleon, the only chameleon we get in this area of South Africa, and they don't have any specific favorites. take this opportunity to give everybody and people who have may have tuned in a bit later on this afternoon's broadcast that as of tomorrow we will be changing the times for the live safaris. We will be going out half an hour later in the morning and we'll be going out an hour earlier in the afternoon. So 6:30 Central African Time morning start until 9:30 and 3 p.m. Central African Time until 6 p.m. Central African Time afternoon drive. And the reason for that is because spending too much time out after dark can be counterproductive, as it's difficult to see animals at night and there's a lot less typically to talk about unless you get lucky. So it makes more time for us to spend the majority of the drive in the daylight, and it's also cooler now than summer and the sun is setting earlier than summer, so things are changing and we need to change with the patterns out here to try and give you the best possible safari available. And that is normal. The safari guides out here, they have the benefits of being able to chop and change for each set of guests that they have, whereas we have to kind of try and choose a time that's going to work over an extended period so that people can get into the routine of when the safaris are. So you will find the game viewers slowly changing their departure times by maybe 10 or 15 minute intervals as it makes sense, but we are doing quite a drastic one. I'm looking forward to the change though, and it should help us to provide a better safari experience for you, which is what we aim to do. Go ahead. Got a question through from Donna in Missouri. Good evening, Donna, and welcome on board with us. Hope everything is well in Missouri. Donna is interested to know whether chameleons live in small groups or if they're solitary, and just like the one we saw earlier, they typically are solitary. The only time you'll find them in concentrated groups is often if you come across an area where baby chameleons may have hatched. So you can sometimes see a bunch of tiny little chameleons together in the same tree, but that's usually only for a few days of within them being or them hatching, and then they naturally start wandering off on their own. But they are self-sufficient when they are born or when they do hatch. I speak for the chameleons that I know of, and possibly in other parts of Africa or the world you'll find chameleons that do live communally, but the chameleons that I've seen in Southern Africa and East Africa are all solitary. Obviously they'll need to join up for mating, but that will just be two of them and it won't be for extended periods of time. Go ahead. Confirm Maria. Okay, we've got a question through from Ria, and Ria's interested. Good evening, Ria. Ria's interested to know whether predators chameleons have to watch out for. And there's a large host of predators that will eat chameleons. I've seen birds eating them, various birds, including hornbills. That's one that comes to mind. Snakes. Mark actually saw and managed to capture footage of a type of snake called a boomslang, meaning a tree snake, feeding on a chameleon, and I've seen that as well before. So certainly snakes and birds will be two predators that will attack them and eat them, and a wide host of birds as well as snakes. I'm sure some of the small nocturnal carnivores like jennets will also try and prey on them, as well as the small mongoose when they are given the opportunity to. So they are sought after, but thankfully they are masked of a leopard's scent mark. Unless, of course, I'm dreaming, which is possible. The smell smells like that of buttered popcorn. It may simply be that I'm smelling, but it's not very fresh. And there are no tracks on the road here. Anyway, that got me excited for a moment. The last time that happened to me successfully, we found Mvula. And we were driving along, smelt the smell in reverse to allow Brian to smell that buttered popcorn smell, as he didn't smell it as we drove past. And after Brian got his turn to smell the popcorn, we drove 50 meters up the road, and there was the leopard right in front of us. And I think, Andrew, you were in FC that morning.
Yeah, I think so.
So it can alert you to the presence of leopards, and who would have thought that they do have this crazy buttered popcorn smell that they leave. It's not always the smell that they will excrete when they do scent mark. Sometimes you can smell it, other times you can't. So not sure of the exact science behind that, but obviously they're telling slightly different stories with the different chemical compounds that they leave on their trails. A radio test. Yeah, we can try it again, much better. Just got a good question through from Christy in Oklahoma. Good evening, Christy, and I hope you're well. And I also hope we find one of the animals that you've asked a question about. Christy has asked whether the owls that we get in this area will migrate to other parts of Africa during our winter. And no, they won't, Christy. All the owls we get here are here year-round, so none of them are migratory. And I've just turned off my lights because there's a few impala up ahead of us. So I just want to skirt past in the darkness to not blind them. So sadly, no, Christy, that's not an excuse we can use for not showing you owls. They haven't left. They should all still be here. Where, I don't know, but we are looking. And hopefully they're going to pop out shortly. And I guess, Christy, just like all the animals here, they move for food, and depending on where there is food, that is where they will be. Go ahead. Sorry, no good again. We'll try again in a few minutes. A lot of the dead trees as we drive past, hoping to find an owl in there, Christy, and all of you. But seeing as though Christy asked the question about owls, I'm gonna do my best to find her one. And they do like to use dead trees as platforms to hunt from, because they can see very clearly everything below them, and it's also easy to take off and land in a tree with no leaves and small branches. Can try again. Sorry, missing a few crucial pieces of that, so we'll try again later. Nikki is trying to send me through some questions, but the radio is letting us down, and therefore I cannot hear the whole part of the message. So apologies for that, but it is what it is, and I just thought I'd keep you updated as to what's going on. much better. So try again there, please.
Liberty in Canada is how it's called. Liberty in Canada is how it's called. Live Liberty.
Well, I don't know what the problem is with these radios, but clearly there is one, and apologies for that, but there's a chance that Andrew's managed to decipher what it is that Nicky's saying. So Andrew, would you mind trying? Well, go for it. Let's see if it sounds.
Liberty in Canada is asking Lionel Leprick.
Yeah?
Lionel Leprick will kill their own, consume their own young under any circumstance, or their own kind. What should this own kind of a young kind?
Okay, well, that's an interesting question, and I'm not sure I understand exactly what you're asking for, Liberty, in Canada, but good evening. And yes, lion will kill and occasionally feed on other lion, and leopard will do the same. I've seen both animals doing it, and I've even seen a female leopard feeding on one of her cubs that was killed by a male leopard. So, yes, they will. However, you'll find that a lot of textbooks say even though lions and leopards may kill one another, they typically don't feed on one another. This is not true. I've seen more often than not them feeding on one another than not feeding on one another. So yes, they do. Thanks, Nicky. And Nicky's just reminded me that the Birmingham Boys, a coalition of five male lions that we did see in kind of December and January, we haven't seen them very much since then, but it's a coalition of five younger male lions, and they killed the lioness and did feed on it, parts of her, and that was here in the Sabi Sands, not far from where we are, but sadly not where we are allowed to actually go. Where are all the animals hiding? I certainly don't know. But it does happen, and it's not abnormal. I'm not surprised that we're having a quiet drive. They do happen from time to time. And especially considering the amounts of action that we've been spoilt with over the last week or so, it's about time we had a quiet drive, just to be able to look back and reflect at how lucky we have been. There's nothing to be alarmed about, but obviously always a little bit disappointing when we know there's so much out here to see, but sometimes we just don't see any of it. And that appears to have been the case this afternoon. Barring one or two characters that managed to show their face briefly. Go ahead. Just got a question through from Kathleen, and it's an interesting one. Good evening, Kathleen, and hope you're having a good evening or morning wherever you are. Kathleen is interested to know whether the hyena that we see here at the den sites on Vuyatela would have been close enough, or Juma, would have been, well, would they have traveled to the giraffe kill in order to try and scavenge the leftovers? And I don't know the answer to that. There's a chance that they could. They move huge distances, hyena. But I wouldn't be able to guarantee whether they would in fact have gone and fed there. And there's not enough research that I know of on the hyena of the Sabi Sands to be able to confirm the distances they move. Animals do need to be researched very heavily to be able to provide any insight into their behavior. And even though there may have been research done on spotted hyena in various other parts of Africa, it will not be applicable to the hyena here, because the hyena here are in a different place and will therefore act very differently. So I'm not sure. I would be inclined to think that it's too far for them to travel, and that it would be unlikely that they'd travel that far. And to give you a distance, in terms of how far I think it is from here to where the giraffe was killed, it's probably around, or from their den site, there's probably around 5 miles, so not hugely far. But I don't think that they necessarily would have traveled off that far, simply because I think they would have come across different clans of hyena. The clans of hyena in the Sabi Sands are quite small, and therefore they'll have smaller territories that they can survive within. Therefore, for the hyena to move out of their territory, they could run into the risk of coming across other clans that would then fight with them. So that's my theory on the situation, but again, very little research is available on the hyena of the Sabi Sands, at least as far as I'm aware. Not lions, hyena. If I said lions, I beg your pardon. Okay. Lucy on Twitter, good evening and welcome on board. I hope you are having a wonderful day wherever you are. Lucy is interested to know whether we ever go on drives between the game drives, the live safari drives that we do. And yes, occasionally we will take out people like Nikki, who are stuck in the final control room, to go out and see the animals in the flesh and go on little joy rides. And thankfully in winter it is cooler and more enjoyable to do it than it would be in summer. In summer it's unbearably hot in the middle of the day, and therefore it wouldn't be comfortable to go out in between the drives. But yes, we do occasionally take out the other crew members and just go out for our own enjoyment, because this is after all our job, and it's nice to go out without a camera on the back and having to think about what we're going to say. So we certainly do go out occasionally just for our own personal enjoyment, and it's definitely one of the perks of the job, being able to head out between the drives at any wilderness camp where you may find yourself working and go out and enjoy the bush to yourself, not necessarily with your guests, and most guides will do that. So just a few minutes left, and I hope you've enjoyed the slow pace of this afternoon's drive. There certainly hasn't been any major action. As I said, that's nothing to worry about. The animals are still here. We just are not in the right place at the right time. And I'm hoping our second vehicle will be up and running tomorrow morning. The mechanic said he would do his best and work late into the night if need be to try and get it fixed, but it may need a little bit more work done in the morning. So that's an update on the second vehicle. And then just one last reminder, tomorrow morning's drive will be starting half an hour later than normal. So we're going to be kicking off at 6:30 Central African time and then continuing for 3 hours until 9:30. So do bear that in mind and tell your friends, spread the word so that nobody is wasting their time half an hour early. And tomorrow afternoon we will be going out 1 hour earlier in the afternoon. Arrived at a big open clearing, and because it's big and open we can see far. Now I'm hoping the fact that we can see far is going to increase our likelihood of actually seeing something, but it appears that the change in habitat is not necessarily changing our change in fortune. So Andrew had spotted something, probably a bird, and I'm guessing it would have been a nightjar. That has flown off. well, folks, thanks so much for joining us this evening, and like I say, I hope you enjoyed a more relaxed cruise through the wilderness this afternoon. And I'm hoping tomorrow it'll be back to some high-paced action. And again, I also hope that we'll have both vehicles up and running. So that is something to look forward to potentially. But other than that, I don't have too much to say. Good night, sweet dreams, or have a good day, depending on where you are. And thanks to Andrew on camera and to Nikki in the final control. From us here at Juma in the Sabi Sands, South Africa, good night till next time.